I want to talk about a special light, optical vortices, and how to get them working in optical tweezers. So the plan for the four lectures is something like this. First, we'll look at optical vortices, and we started to do it yesterday with Bill at the very last lecture. I'll continue from there and familiarize you with the vortex fields and how they look. And after that, I will switch over to optical tweezers, because what I want to do in lecture number 3 and 4 is to apply the optical vortex fields to optical tweezers, and then show you that by merging these two technologies, I can measure the angular momentum of light directly, and I can apply it to fine things as well. So it's all about things like this. We want things to acquire angular momentum of light and rotate. And the question is, can we quantify it? Can we understand the physics of it? And can we do it with this optical vortex fields? So first of all, where am I from? Not very far from here. I'm from Australia. So a few nasty and very nice animals here. So everybody knows about kangaroos and koalas and beautiful birds, and then we are very scared of redbacks and snakes. And we have them for everyday life, if you want to believe me. So this is where I come from. This is Brisbane. Australia is vast, populated by people around the coast, and a desert in the middle. So that's Australia, and that's our city of Brisbane along the river. This is our university at the bend of the river. And if you won't be able to check me, this is the view from my window, if I lean very, very far out. Okay, so the optical micromanipulation, let's see. This is my group in Sweden, in Australia. Sorry, I just came from Sweden, so we are zooming in. And that's the university, and that's our ugly building. And here we are, whatever we are doing, we are doing with constructing optical tweezers. So we need laser, we need a little bit of optics. Here's the optics, we manipulate the beams, beam splitters, gratings, etc. Here we have double tweezers, and I'll talk about it a little bit later. And then we put it through high numerical aperture objective, and we look at it either in a CCD camera or quadro detector. Two ways of looking at the motion of the particles and what happens with them. And we can use them to move micron-sized objects, and we can construct many, many traps, and we can play with a lot of traps and see how they behave. And of course, for that, we can use all sorts of types of light and then measure quantitatively everything that happens to these trap particles. But that's not the end of the story, of course, because you can also use it in other areas of physics, like, for example, in cold atoms, which was mentioned by Bill yesterday. So anyway, what I want to concentrate on is to look at vortex beams. So in particular, I'll be looking at Gauss-Bagier beams of light, and it will become clear why. I want to today look at how to produce Bagier-Gauss beams of light, look at the angular momentum in the next lecture, and then introduce tweezers in the middle of the double to show you how I can measure the transfer of angular momentum and torque. And then I want to use orbital angular momentum in particular, because it's a very special thing as far as Gauss-Bagier beams of light are concerned, to micromanipulation and application both in physics and biology. So that's the grand plan. Please do interrupt me anytime there is something which is fishy. Okay, so you all know, and yesterday Bill talked about it as well, that if I want to treat Gaussian beams, it is transfer electromagnetic mode of light, and I can express the complex field amplitude by this equation, and the solution to the Helmholtz equation that he was solving for you yesterday. So this is one of the solutions, and we can see here the amplitude of the light and the behavior of the beam, and it will give us, if we were to plot it, give us the typical Gaussian alpha of intensity longitude. And we are looking here at R being radial distance from the center of the beam, Z being axial distance from the beam narrowest point, which we call the waist of the beam, and omega is the radius where the field amplitude intensity goes, is equal to 1 over E. And capital R of Z is radius of the curvature of the beam's wavefront. And then we have this Galois phase shift here, extracted from the proper phase shift. Okay, so Gaussian beam, as I said, if we take instantaneous intensity profile, this is how it looks. This is very familiar Gaussian beam profile, and this is how it looks when we plot it. So it's very uniform distribution, falling off like as 1 over E, and you can see that you can measure the intensity and amplitude, the plot intensity and amplitude. Okay, so that's Gaussian beam. But what we want to look at are higher order modes. So if we go back to that, what I just showed you before, the mode of light that we are looking at here is Laguerre polynomial of the order 0, 0. So this is associated Laguerre polynomial of order P and index L, but for Gaussian beam, both of those indices are equal to 0. Okay, so now we want to go to higher order modes. So I want to take my Helmholtz equation and solve it again and look at the higher order mode solutions. So so this is, can be represented as various other sets of orthogonal solutions to Karatsev wave equations, so the Helmholtz equation. Observe that we are looking here at Karatsev approximation. And we want to look at Hamming Gauss modes, Laguerre Gauss modes. We can construct solutions which are represented by Hamming Gauss modes, Laguerre Gauss modes, Ince Gauss modes, and hypergeometrical Gaussian modes, and so it goes. But really, what I want to do is to show you the equation which will describe all this, but then I want to pick up this particular modes of light and play with Gauss. Okay, so if we were to look at Hamming Gauss mode of light and we plot the intensity of that light, then this is our polynomials. So this is our well-known Gaussian profile that I showed you before, and these are the higher order Gaussian modes. And you can see how the intensity is varying, and then we have very specific intensity profiles. You can see that, for example, 2,0 L with P equal 2 and L equals 0 is perpendicular to the reverted mode. And so on. So we can construct as many as we wish such modes, and we can look at the intensity of the modes in Laguerre-Gaussian modes, and again, Gauss, a Gaussian profile. And then when index P equals 1, then and L equals 0, we get Gauss-Laguerre of order 1, we say. Okay, and so we go up, and you can see what's characteristic in this first row, and this is the row I will be really concentrating upon, is that when one of the indices, this P index, is equal to 0, I have very characteristic intensity profile, as in I have one ring around a dark spot. And it can be shown that the phase varies in proportion to this index P, which I'll show you in a minute. If, however, we look at higher orders, we can see that numbers of rings is growing, and we still have, in all those higher orders, we have intensity minimum in the very middle of the spot. Okay, so again, what are those Laguerre-Gauss beams of light? They are solutions, still orthogonal mode solutions of scalar Karatsev wave approximation, a wave equation, and this is how they look like. And now let's look at the different parts of it. So this part here describes transverse extent of the field as a function of spot size. And this one gives us the characteristic profile that we have seen in the previous slide. Namely, this is a transverse variation of the amplitude of the field. And so my Gaussian profile is here, and then higher order 0-1 mode is characterized by this intensity amplitude profile. And the higher, observe that too, that the higher the mode, the further from the center the bright amplitude ring resides. And it's also a little bit squished. So this is very characteristic for Gaussian beams of light. So if we go to the next one, this particular term gives the rotation of the phase on the scale of an optical cycle. Okay, and here, what is plotted here, I should have added, is that if we look at this polynomials in all of them, t equals zero, and then we vary L as we go up in the noise. Okay, and the other thing to notice here is that the shape and the twist are retained as the beam propagates. Okay? So the shape and the twist, we haven't been talking much about the twist, but we will, is retained as the beam propagates. So I can propagate those beams quite long distance and the shape will retain the same. Okay, so what are they again? That superposition of Hermite Gauss modes of light, this, the profiles that I was showing you before. And how can we construct them? We can construct them holographically by interference, and we can do on-axis holograms, off-axis holograms, we can have static holograms or dynamic holograms. And these are all possibilities of constructing them. When I talk about dynamic holograms, I'm basically talking about spatial light modulators, where in time I can vary the production of those beams. So what is most characteristic? What do you think is most characteristic? That was, Ivan said to me that we would have clickers here, but I don't have it installed here, so we will have to do it just by raising hands. So the first question to you, because you are so quiet, is what is most characteristic when the high amounts of light propagate? Is it shape and twist being retained, size of the intensity distribution of the nodes is constant, or polarization changes at the beam propagates? Who is for C? Okay, and why do you think so? You just guess. So it's quite interesting. We'll be talking later on about polarization of those beams, and we can impose different polarization profiles on those beams, but these are retained when the beam propagates. Okay? Size of the intensity distribution of the modes is constant. Well, why do you think so? They retain their shape, we said, so I'm giving you an answer that really A is the answer to my question. But as the beam propagates, it's very difficult not to get it estimated. So the size won't be the same, but the shape and twist will be the same. Pity that I don't have this thing installed. Anyway, okay. So these are the beams we are talking about. So this is like a Gauss beam of light. And we said when those indices are, the first index is zero, then we have this so-called donut beams.
One question.
Sorry, yes.
What do you mean by twist of the beams?
Okay, so the beam is carrying, we haven't spoken about it yet, but beam is carrying orbital angular momentum. And so how the beam twists in 3D is retained. So the orbital angular momentum and the pointing vector position is retained as the beam propagates. That's what I mean by that. Okay, so as I said, these are Gauss-Laguerre or Laguerre-Gauss beams of light. People say Gauss-Laguerre, Laguerre-Gauss, whatever is correct. And so this is how they look, but I will be only going here because I want to have donut beams. Okay? So my index P will be always zero. So that, as I said, the characteristic for it is that then I have phase singularity in the middle, which depends on the charge, and the intensity profile around the ring is the one ring only. So these are called donut beams.
The per axial approximation is not an exact solution to Maxwell's equation. So in what sense the angular momentum is conserved then?
Okay, that's a very good question. You can show that although per axial approximation is not exact solution to the Maxwell equations, in per axial regime, orbital angular momentum will be retained. Now you will catch me up on that, what I just said, because in all applications that I'll be talking about, per axial approximation actually does not work perfectly. But we can come back to it when I'm done. Okay, so at the moment I'm treating it only in per axial approximation, right? So I'm saying that the beams, everybody knows what per axial approximation is? Okay, so if I'm treating beam, if I have optics axis and the beam is propagating, I'm saying that everything is happening very close to the axis. Everything which is happening there, I'm not interested in. This is per axial approximation. So if I take, for example, to give you an example of non-per axial situations, if I would focus beams very, very, very tightly, for example, put them through high numerical aperture lens, then of course the beam is not traveling in straight lines along the axis, but is diverging from straight lines. And this will be the situation I'll be looking about on, and still maintaining that I can use per axial approximation or showing you other solutions to those. Okay, so back to this. So these are the beams I'm interested in. As I said, I want only to look at donut beams. So the name tells you how they look, right? Like donuts. Okay, so we can see that L for those donut beams is 1, 2, 3, and so forth. And these waves have helical wavefronts. So we are going now, Christian, to this helicity stuff. And angular momentum eigenmodes are L, H bar per photon. So each photon here, depending on what is the charge of my donut, will carry the charge times H bar per photon of angular momentum. Okay? And that's very important for all the applications that I want to use it for. And then each of those beams has phase singularity on axis. And that phase singularity means that the change of the phase is taking place and it closes on itself after 2pi here, 4, 6, etc. And as we go, the characteristic thing is all the time that I'll have the dark spot in the middle and the phase closes on itself either after 2pi, 4pi, 6pi, etc. etc. Now I can generate them by lasers, and this is the oldest method people have used, by playing with the cavity, putting a little spot in the cavity, you can produce them in the lasers. Or you can use different types of phase plates or holograms. So there are different methods of producing them. Okay, so how do we produce them? So now what I want to do, if I go back, I want to be able to produce all sorts of Gauss-Laguerre beams of light which look like this. So the question is, okay, so how does my phase plate look like in order to produce beam like that? Okay, so this is how it looks like. So I'm looking at helical wavefronts, and so I have my Gaussian beam. I have some sort of phase plate which changes the phase by 2pi, and then what comes out is this helical structure beam. So what's characteristic here? And the thickness of this plate is very important, because what I have is the plane wave through a spiral phase plate is supposed to be the thickness of the plate alpha phi, which is this step thickness, should be integer times wavelength of light that I'm using minus times n minus 1. So what is characteristic for it? we can see the hole in the middle, and the pointing vector of the wave is describing this helical structure. Okay? And this wave, of course, can be linearly or otherwise polarized, that doesn't matter. What matters here is that the pointing vector is describing this helical structure, helical motion. So the other way of doing it is, if I want to have donut 01, I take, this is my phase, this is the intensity profile of interference plate, and if I add these two together, what you can see is that I have something like a discontinuity in the middle, and this discontinuity in the middle, it's interesting, we're talking about Miles' stuff and he comes online, that's pretty nice. Okay, so all these three or four slides here are from Max Paget's group in Glasgow. Okay, so first order, donut beam here it is, and it has been first shown very long time ago by Soskind's group in general in modern optics, that if you take these intensity profiles, you add them together, you get this fork-like structure, and if I put this fork-like structure in the way of Gaussian beam, and I center the Gaussian beam onto this structure, in the outcoming transmitted beam, I'll get 0.01 Gauss radial beam of light. Okay?
Excuse me. Those plates, they're made of what?
Okay, that's a very good question. There are several ways of making them. One is that you take a profile, computationally produced profile like this, and then you take a holographic picture of a holographic plate out of it. So this is, can be holographic plate, okay. just static plate,
yeah.
On which you produce, you can produce such a pattern of it. And then you put the holographic...
So it's not matter, it's something...
Sorry?
It's not
it's glass.
It's glass.
It's glass, and glass has film on it.
Yeah.
You expose the film to this pattern, you mimic that pattern on the film, and then you have glass with that film on it, and then you can put it in the way of the beam. Okay, that's one. The other one is phase plate. So you vary the phase as you go around the middle of it, often done with liquid crystals. The other one is that you use spatial light modulators and you use specific algorithm which will produce, in effect, patterns like that. Then you impose it on the beam and you get your Gauss-Lagier beams of light. Okay, so after you've done all this, of course, you can use different patterns, some of different patterns here, to produce higher order modes. And here I summarized calculations for many such models. So here's the one we've seen before, and the number of twists is changing as we're changing the charge of the donut. And you can see there are many, many twists. Eventually, we can go to charge, very high charges, and those high charges, donut modes, have been used in many parts of physics. And what is characteristic about this higher and higher and higher order Gauss-Lagier beams of light is, of course, that per photon, as I told you, each of the photons carries the charge times h bar of orbital angular momentum. So if I want to have very high orbital angular momentum beams, then I need to go to very high charges of the donut, which is doable. Again, the same way as we were talking before, it can be done on holographic plates, on much harder glass, which can be etched. It can be done with face plates and also with spatial light modulators.
So for the last figure, you have like 50?
No. It's all produced with one hologram.
I understand, but if I read, if I
oh,
see...
Oh yeah, 50 terms, yeah. Yes. The other characteristic thing is, and we'll be talking about later, is that if I plotted the intensity profile of this beam, then the ring is getting narrower and narrower, the higher the light ring is getting narrower and narrower, and the hole is getting bigger and bigger, the higher the charge of the beam. Okay, so let's go. Okay, so this is how it all works. I have helical wavefront, so this is how it looks like for L equal 1. And for L equal 3, you can see that those helices are sort of intertwisted to each other. And this shows you this helical wavefront coming up, and so how the momentum of the beam looks like is shown here. And I have orbital angular momentum here, R cross P. Okay, so production, as I said, here is the example of on-axis and off-axis hologram for generation of 0-4, for example, laser. Okay, and then this actually is quite distorted. Don't look at it carefully because I have enlarged the figure and something happened with it. But that was supposed to have a number of forks. As we go up in the charge of the donut, what happens is that the forky structure, the dislocation-like structure, gets many, many more spikes on it, right? But it all goes to zero in this point. And so now if I put my Gaussian beam on this, plane wave on that, in the transmission I will get 0,8 Laguerre Gauss mode. So now I will follow it up with few, before I go to more details about how to characterize them and what to do with them, I want to show you a few examples where people have been using Gauss Laguerre beams of light in many very fancy applications. So here is a work from Anton Zeilinger's group, where they are looking at the entanglement of the orbital angular momentum states of photons. So this is, and this is done at the level of almost a single photon. So what we do here is that we take laser light, we put it through a crystal which then produces two different wavelengths of light, either and the source, and then we put them through this holograms here of certain order, whatever the order we choose them to do. And then in the transmitted light, we look at the entanglement between this photon and this photon, which are both in some orbital angular momentum mode. And then I have detectors here, and I look at the coincidence measurement between them. And you can see that the entanglement is pretty substantial here in those measurements. And as I said, this is done with this holographic, static holographic plates. Okay, so that was one example. And another one is that we often, and I will be doing it in a different way, but we want to measure the orbital angular momentum of single photon. Okay? I won't go that far in the methods that I'll be showing you in lectures in this week. I will never measure it in a single photon, but here, the group of Mars budget have been working on it for measurement of orbital angular momentum for a single photon. So this is a characteristic stuff which is happening here when the beam is coming. So I have input beam. These are Duff prisms. So one Duff prism, what they do, I don't know how, whether you know what a Duff prism is, but if I put a Gaussian beam on a Duff prism, on the output of it, I will get circularly polarized light. Okay? Okay. And also a donut beam. So, and if I turn the Duff prism, one will be circularly polarized one way and one will be circularly polarized the opposite way. And so here is, then we combine them in a beam splitter and then we can look at the outcome from the transmission, sorry, the detection of light in A1 in B2, and this is what we'll see. So this is the characteristic intensity profile for different types of gas that they use of light. We can also do a spatial mode tomography with coherent states. And so basically the question is to produce coherent states. And then here we have two holograms. I would like to draw your attention to that because I will be doing it in a similar way later in the week. Namely, I produce a photon here. So the Gaussian beam, we haven't gone through that, but through in the transmission in the zero order area. So this is the, this word like works like this hologram works like diffraction grating. So in the straightforward beam in zero direction, I will have what I had in my laser. So it's normally Gaussian beam. And then I have a Gauss-like beam of light propagating here. I put it on the other hologram, and what it means is that I can now decompose, and I will show you more details of it later. I can decompose the light which is transmitted through that hologram, and then measure different outputs with my detector. Okay, and here is another totally different example of what those beams, Gauss-Allier beams of light can be used for. This is work from Monika Rishmata's group, where what is done, and it's interesting lecture in itself, but I don't have enough time to go through details very much here. But basically what it's done here is that we have coherent illumination. So this is done in microscopy, and the idea here is that in many biological samples, the contrast in microscope is very low. And if you want to enhance the contrast in the microscope, what can you do? The optical microscope has diffraction limitations, and if you want to enhance the contrast, you have to somehow overcome diffraction limitations. So this is producing some sort of super resolution arrangements, and this is one of them. That by using this spatial light modulators and producing hollow beams or Gauss-Allier beams of light, we can enhance the images very substantially. Okay, and now this is just a curiosa. I won't go through it in many details, but this twisted light has been used or detected or used in rotation of black holes. It has been used in electrons. So if you have electron microscope, transmission microscope, you can produce also with certain tricks of the fields, E fields that is used for diffraction of electron beam, you can also produce this very characteristic Gauss-Allier beams of photon, of electrons in this case, rather than photons. And again, this is, as we were talking about, this is what characterizes them. In the zero order, I have my Gauss's electron beam, Gaussian electron beam, and then as I go to the side, it's minus 1 plus 1, or sorry, minus 25 plus 25, minus 50 plus 50, and so on. So that's in electrons, and we won't talk about this, and I will skip that one. This is too many examples. So anyway, so to come to the chase of it, what we want to do is to take this beams of light which carry orto angular momentum or sometimes also spin angular momentum and use them for different applications in optical micromanipulation. So what is optical micromanipulation? How many of you deal with optical tweezers? Okay, all right, so for you it will be all old stuff. But for others, I'll go through it. So what we are talking here about is really radiation pressure force of light, okay? And so this has been known for a very long time. I think it was 1667, if I remember correctly, that Kepler said that if you look at the comet, the tails of the comets, you can see that they're turning away from sunlight. And it had to do with the fact that the little particles in there of dust in the comet tail were sort of light enough to be affected by the momentum of light. And we all know that light carries energy, we get hot when we're standing in the sun, but that it carries momentum is a little bit more difficult to realize in everyday life. And it has to do with the fact that we are a little bit too heavy to feel the push. because if it is momentum, we have to feel the push. But if you have little particles of order of microns in size, well, they weigh so little that the push can be quite substantial on them. So here is a little calculation of how big that push is. So if I take 10 milliwatt of helium neon, I focus it to a spot which is as big as the wavelength of light. So this is 632.8 nanometers. I put it onto an object of the same diameter as the wavelength of light, with the density which is 1 gram per centimeter square cube. And I assume that the particle absorbs, that it's reflecting 10% of light, and as it, and it's very flat, and it acts as a mirror. Okay, so the momentum change of the laser light each second will be that much. Okay, 2 times 10 to minus 3 divided by speed of light. And if we have to conserve the momentum, this will result in a force on the particle of approximately picometer. Okay, so the question is that, of course, such a force, although it is large on a particle like this, but if we were to make this particle really large and very heavy, then of course this force would be so little that it wouldn't be any way of measuring it. Okay? But what I will convince you about is that forces like that can be easily measured. Okay? Okay, so what at the end of the day, this simple calculation and the size of the particle and the size of the beam, remember the beam was very small, I have more than 1,000 times the acceleration due to the gravity. So it's quite an immense effect if you look at it that way. Okay, so how does it work? It can be looked upon in several ways. So here I'm showing you the Gaussian beam, and it has a waist here. We were talking about the waist before. And I have particles slightly away from the center of the beam. So I'm treating it as 2 rays coming onto the particle from this Gaussian beam. It's not quite right, it's quite a, the Rayleigh approximation is, Rayleigh optics approximation is pretty rough, but it tells us a little bit what's happening. So we get forces acting on this particle, and as you see, if I am closer to the center of the beam, the intensity is much larger, and so the force Fa will be larger than force Fb, and so the particle will be drawn to the most intense angle of the beam, to the middle of the beam. Okay? And that's called, so we have scattering force acting on the particle, and then we have then gradient force, which is pulling it to the most intense light of the beam. And that is true for both, it works slightly differently for atoms, but it's true for both particles of different sizes in the micrometer regime as it works for the atoms. So the most important part of this slide is that the sphere can be pulled into the center of the beam and propelled in the direction of the beam propagation by radiation pressure. But if I make the gradient force bigger than the scattering force, then I can trap the particle in the most intense part of the beam, or very close to the most intense part of the beam. Okay, so in summary, this is what we said. I have photons coming towards an object. There will be force acting on them of 2hk on it. And what happens with the particle is shown in a sketch here. Wherever the particle is, it's drawn to the most intense part of the beam. And this was studied by Ashby a very long time ago. And what can we do with it? As I said, the principle is very simple. I can combine it with measurement and theory, and I'll get very powerful tools. And typical numbers for this type of trapping is that if I have 10 milliwatts laser with radius and particle of the radius of 1 micron, then the forces I'm exerting are of that order that we were talking about. Okay? Okay, so this technique is this is very simple stuff. What I need is, in principle, high numerical aperture objective, and few things will happen in there if we send the light to high numerical aperture objective. And it's first of all, I focus it to target on this laser spot. I have intensity gradient, and I can look at the stiffness which will be set up by the laser power and the objective numerical aperture. I can measure forces from deflection of the laser beam. It has incredibly high resolution. It is femtonewton resolution and short times. The single receptor studies has been done using this method. Force measurements have been done in three dimensions. Closed sample chambers and microfluidic devices, it has been used in, and so on and so forth. Now, there are limits to what is the maximum force I can measure with this device. And if I want to use it in biology, of course, the question is whether the things that I'm studying will not absorb the light, because if they do, there will be radiation damage. And the other thing is that calculations are easiest done on spheres, and majority of things that we trap are not spheres. So my group actually has devoted a lot of time lately to look at trapping of non-spherical objects, which I won't have time to talk about. But if you want to know about it, please let me know. Okay, so again, in summary, how it works is that I can do this trapping by looking in two pictures, so ray optics model I can use, or I can use force on a point dipole. And ray optics model is really quite simple to understand, so I have beam coming in. The particle has higher refractive index than surrounding. The light bends, and then when it comes out again, it bends again, so I have force upwards. I'm acting here if my beam is focused above the center of the sphere. Now, if the beam is focused below the center of the sphere, you can see that we will have the force acting upwards. And to the side, if the beam is focused to the side, this will be pushing particle to the most intense part of the beam. And the same thing happens here. Our particle is trying to attain the minimum energy state, and so it will seek itself to the most intense part of the beam. So force results from the exchange of momentum with the beam. Okay, very simple. Treatment will show us that the force acting on the object that we are trapping here will be proportional to the refractive index, to the power of the laser that I use for trapping, divided by the speed of light, and multiplied by efficiency factor that we can measure. And this is what we want to do here, because all of it is done in the environment, a liquid environment. We have drag force acting on it, or gas environment for that matter. So we have drag force acting on it, and so a lot of people online, I'm sorry about this. Oops, no. Okay, a lot of, so we have drag acting on it, and it's viscous drag, so it's very simple stuff here. So it will be proportional to the viscosity of the medium, to the size of the particle which is being trapped, and the maximum velocity with which I'm pulling the particle out of the trap. Okay, so if I set this to this side of the equation equal, then we can calculate my efficiency factor here to be proportional to the viscosity and the size of the particle. So if I really want to characterize the trap very well, there are certain things that I have to be able to measure very precisely. One is power, and you would say that it's no difficulty measuring the power of the laser, and we'll come back to that. The other one is measuring the size of the particle, because if we were to look at the, I'll show you that later anyway, so it's proportional to the size of the particle and viscosity. And all of those, and if the and this is only true, of course, for spherical particles, right? If it's spherical particle, we can do it very easily, but those three parameters are very important to be able to measure precisely. So for non-convinced, here is another pictorial of showing you what trapping is all about. So I have a beam on the light which is being bent like in a lens. So it's pulled, and it's pulled to the very center of the beam in there. But my beam of light is not raised, straight raised, but it's very highly focused laser beam. So this is the picture which is happening. So the light is being bent as it goes through the particle, and I can measure. You can imagine that I can put a detector here and measure what's happening with the light which is transmitted. Yep.
What is the size limitations?
That's a very good question. So there is work done on trapping very, very tiny particles. We can talk about it because it becomes very difficult to trap something which is of the order of a few nanometers. And then there are limitations on the higher size. However, people have shown that the invisible macro particles can also be trapped. So the span of trapping is very, very large. So people have trapped single molecules, although they were pretty big, but people have trapped whole organelles and big, big cells as well. Okay, so this is what is happening. So it goes into the middle, and of course if I have particle there somewhere in the beam, then it comes to the middle, or just below the middle actually. So you can see that I didn't put it exactly in the focal spot, was slightly below, and there is a reason for it, but we will talk about it later. So, okay, so for all of those who don't do optical tweezers, and we again don't have clickers, because I wasn't quick enough, what is most essential for achieving trapping in 3D? Can we talk about it? So I listed here highly focused laser light, large scattering force, trapped object to be orders of magnitude smaller than the wavelength of light used for trapping. So if we start with large scattering force, what can we say about that? So you remember that we said that if I send laser light to my particle, there are two forces acting. One is scattering, which is pushing the particle out of the in the direction of the beam, and the other one is gradient force. So what happens now if the scattering force is too large? It will just be propelled in the beam, right? And it will, the gradient force will be too small to keep it in the most intense part of the beam. And it's often a problem in optical tweezers that the gradient force is smaller than the scattering force, and therefore it is impossible to trap the high force, right? But if I play with that, so you would say, okay, well, put more power into the laser light. Right, we have laser beams, so laser beam power can be varied. So I could put more laser power and then trap. But again, if the balance between gradient and scattering force is wrong, depending on refractive index of the particle, size of the particle, etc., then scattering force can still be too big to trap the power. Agree? So it's definitely not B. Okay. So which one is it?
C.
A? Mm-hmm. Okay. And why isn't it C?
You just said that
it's,
so you've been able to optically trap
my transistors. Yeah, but I also said to Christian's answer that I can trap nanometers part.
Yes.
But
nanometers.
That's right. So the order of magnitude is still much bigger than what I'm stating in C. So, yes, I can't trap particles which are much, much smaller than the one. Okay, so the typical setup, actually, that was what I was going to do. So what do you think you need for a typical setup? Can you give me a list what to go and buy to make optical tweezers? Okay. Let's start.
Laser.
What do we need? Laser. Okay. Laser. Okay, we need laser. And next one. What else do we need?
High NA objective.
High NA objective. 1.4.
Yeah.
Maybe. Not necessary. understanding, but yes, high numerical objective. Something of the order of more than one, okay? So she was saying more than one. Okay, and what else?
Yeah. Power supply.
Power supply for the laser, yeah? Plus power supply.
How do you want to trap the particle?
How do I want to trap it?
Do you want to trap it in a position, or do you want to be able to make it flow in a vertical direction? Or?
You tell me, and I'll do it.
Okay, so if you want to flow it in a vertical direction, maybe you can use the SLP, and then you generate the...
You don't
need a Gauss model, maybe you don't need that.
Not yet. I just want to have basic optical tweezers, and then we will talk about Gauss again.
You've got one.
I got one. And in principle, yes, I need a little bit of, I need a few particles and a stage.
Yeah.
And somehow I have to observe all that, so I need some sort of detector. Yeah? So I can have camera or, what is it, position sensitive detector or something of this sort. Okay, and I got myself tweezers. So this is exactly what I got here. So I have laser lines. So basically you can go home, take any microscope, quite poor quality microscope as long as you have good laser and good numerical aperture. And you can just send the laser. So there are a few little things which are important with it. Namely, I have a laser going through a couple of lenses. Why do I do that? Is because I want to fill this high numerical aperture objective so that the light is as focused as I can get it and as much of it is coming to the focus spot to have the best possible tracking here, okay? And so I have here a dichroic mirror because normally what you do in a microscope is that the light comes this way. So you have to put dichroic mirror to be able to put laser beams here. Okay. So dichroic mirror, everybody knows how it works, so it transmits the light which we illuminate the particle with, but it reflects the light of the laser. So no laser light, in principle, is going upwards. So this is my viewing system or my detection system here, and I have a stage of a microscope and a solution with my particles or whatever, cells or whatever I want to trap. And and I can get very strong traps. And if I want to go to what you were talking about, very simple. I take a plate, holographic plate, or light from an SLM, or whatever it happens to be, so it can be only lambda over 2 plate, or it can be lambda over 4 plate, I can get the spherically polarized light, a light carrying spin angular momentum. Or I can, instead of this plate, put my hologram, and then have Gauss Laguerre beams on it, or whatever beams on it, ins Gauss, whatever. Okay, and then I can do the detection either in light which is reflected from the particle, because there will be always light reflected from the particle, or transmitted. It depends what I want to do. And at the end of lecture number, whatever it will be, I'll show you that not only can you put these fancy holograms in the beams that are coming into optical tweezers, but you can put it on the microscope slide and create Gauss Laguerre beams of light in situ, so to speak. Okay, so I have a couple of minutes left, right? Is that right?
Yep.
Okay, so what is happening with optical tweezers? I will show you a little bit of modeling tomorrow, but today I just want to give you a little bit of pictorial what's happening. So basically you can imagine that this particle which is being trapped by highly focused laser light acts as a lens. Okay? So I have my plane wave coming, or highly focused wave, whatever it is, onto a particle, and what is shown here, this is all simulation, calculation down here, on a certain size of the particle, which is about 2 microns, I think, in this case. You can see that there is a very strong intensity, changes in intensity profile in the light which is transmitted through this lens. And so if I am able to measure what's happening here with this transmitted light, I can characterize my trapping force. So let us see whether we can get a drawing here. So what I'm doing here is that I'm varying the position of my highly focused laser beam, which came through a high numerical aperture objective, and I'm moving it in Z direction. Okay? So I'm going higher and lower up in the trap. Where is it now? Okay, here we go. Okay, and so the particle is moving, it's a bit jerky here, but it's moving. And you can see that the profile, I'm showing on my screen, which is not good idea. You can see how big changes there are in the profile that is transmitted through the particle, of the light transmitted through the particle. So if we only have possibilities of measuring what's happening there, then I can plot this quality factor or the force acting on the particle very, very precisely as I'm varying this thing. Okay, so let's try that again. So you can see that this transmitted light, if I were able to collect it all, will give me the measure of everything that is happening in this stably trapped part. Okay, so this is how it looks, just to impress you a bit. Okay, so here I have a particle. They are 2 microns in size. I'm trapping this fellow and I'm moving the stage. The microscope stage is moved in X and Y direction. And you can see that the particles sometimes bump each other and come out of the trap. But the trap keeps this one pretty strongly trapped, although I'm moving the stage quite substantially with cross-axial speed. And of course you can see that it's not that strong that it doesn't push its particles out. But the other interesting thing, if I repeat it again, is that if you watch these particles here, all the ones which are not trapped, you can see that they are jiggling in liquid. This is described by Brown and motion, right? And you can also see that this particle which is trapped still jiggles a little bit. And I want you to remember that, because this will be something that we'll be using to characterize the trap. So what I will do in the following lecture is to show you how to characterize this trapping force and position and what we can do with it then when we apply it to these fancy laser beams, which are Gauss-like air beams of light. But that will be tomorrow. Thank you.
Movie that you just saw, I found out that the particle which was trapped, when the other particles move with the stage, the particle can push it and then take the
yes.
place of the trap.
Yes. Yes. Why is it
happening?
Okay. And let's go back. So what happens back? Okay. So what happens here is that the trap has certain stiffness, right? And if the force of this other particle which is coming towards the trapped one is larger than the trapping force, then of course I will push the particle out. Okay? But what is interesting is that I'm pushing it and that next particle, it's enough, so the distance becomes large enough and that particle stays trapped there till another one pushes it out.
If so you can make the stiffness too much so that it cannot like move?
Well, you can increase stiffness to a certain extent, but
okay.
eventually there is a limit.
Okay.
And we'll look at it tomorrow. Okay. Yeah?
Just for curiosity, are there any indications for local field effects in the environment, so to speak, the reactor?
Yes.
As a secondary source of.
Oh yes. There are
more.
Oh yes. Absolutely. Onsager effects in the scene.
Okay.
And then there are several papers about that in the literature. Because those effects are rather, well, reasonably easy to observe. Yeah.
Did you have something that you can't do this experiment?
I can't hear you. Can you speak up? So are you asking me whether it is possible to do work on living organisms because they observe? So this is the staining problem in optical tweezers when they are used in biological applications, where there are a lot of discussions in the literature what sort of wavelength should be used for living organisms in order to harm the least as possible. And there is a window, you know, that you can get lasers at any wavelength, right? So majority of people working with optical tweezers work at about 1 micron, but it has been shown that if you are working in a biological environment, it's much better to work around 800, because it's not only a question of absorption by the organism, but also by water. So there is a window where the water absorbs the lessest amount of energy. And so therefore there will be the lessest amount of energy. And there are a lot of papers which have been treating this sort of problem. So for example, there's work that has been shown that optical tweezers can, for example, used in vitro fertilization. So there's a big problem whether, okay, you can do it, but will the embryo develop? And it has been shown that although they could measure a certain increase in temperature, that increase wasn't enough to harm the process. So that's pretty interesting. But then you can ask how much do you need to harm? That's very difficult because it varies between different organisms and different situations and cells and whatever. Any more?
Okay, we have to go to coffee break and we'll start here around the corner.